I turned my mic on.
Is it not already on?
Okay, now it's on. You'll please take your seats. Commissioner Willis, will you move us in the invocation and the pledge to join us?
Our Father, thank you for this day and opportunity we all have to live in those miles of buildings. Bless those who come to be here tonight, to hear and to listen and to speak, and for the commissioners and for our elected officials. We give you thanks. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Welcome everyone to our Army Planning Commission meeting. Before we get started, I'm going to read the procedures. Review them for you. The Island Planning Commission considers applications for preliminary subdivision plat, site plans, and village preservation permits. In addition, the Island Planning Commission considers requests for rezonings, a conditional and special use permits, and ordinance amendments. The Planning Commission makes final decisions on preliminary plats, site plans, and village preservation permits, and makes recommendations on the board to the Board of Commissioners on all other items. The Islands Planning Commission allows public comments for preliminary plats, site plans, and village preservation permits. The Commission holds public hearings for rezonings, conditional and special use permits, and zoning ordinance amendments. The planning staff presents their findings to the Planning Commission during the staff report. This report evaluates how the proposal conforms to the Glynn County zoning ordinance and other applicable regulations and conforms to the comprehensive plan and apply to zoning matters and general amendments to the ordinances. Applicants shall have the opportunity to present their requests to the Planning Commission. It is the responsibility of the applicants to make presentations on requests and to address any conditions or factual findings with which they do not agree. Public hearings and public comments will be limited to 30 minutes for each opposing side, with a maximum of 5 minutes allocated to each speaker. Comments are to be limited to relevant information regarding the position and should avoid being repetitious. If your group has a spokesperson, please allow that individual to present your group's position in the time allotted. The applicant may then provide a rebuttal to any testimony. The chairman may terminate testimony if it becomes repetitive. The chairman will terminate a speaker's time if the speaker begins personal attacks. Your cooperation in this process will be greatly appreciated. And for those that have been following our IPC, the Board of Commissioners at its May 4th meeting approved our public comment policy. So we are now at a new policy of public comment. Our first item of order business is approve the minutes of the regular meeting held April 18, 2017, subject to the necessary corrections. However, those minutes are not available at this time due to certain requests to have them transcribed verbatim, so that's going to take a little longer. We'll have those at another time. Our second item of business is election of chairman for 2017. We now have 7 commissioners available, so we'll go forward with this month. From the election committee, is there a nomination?
Madam Chairman, the nomination committee nominates Desiree Watson as chair for 2017.
Okay. Are there any nominations from the floor?
I'd like to acknowledge Ed Meadows as chairperson.
Mr. Martin? As chairperson, Ed Meadows. Are there any other nominations? The nominations are now closed. Okay, then for the first nominee, Desiree Watson, all those in favor of Ms. Watson being chair for the remainder of 2017, please raise your hand. That's four, I guess, are being chair for the year. Thank you, Commissioner.
Ms. Chairwoman. Our attorney has requested that the minutes, if they're not ready, they be deferred to the next regularly scheduled meeting.
Okay, we'll take a motion to defer these. Will they? Okay, is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor of deferring to our next regular meeting, please raise your right hand. That's unanimous. Yes? Okay. Our next order of business is consider an amendment to section 219-5 of the Code of Ordinances to allow the Board of Commissioners to establish a schedule of meetings for the planning commissions and to clarify that 4 votes are necessary to transact business. Under the proposal, the Islands Planning Commission would only hold a regular meeting in February, April, June, August, October, and December, unless and until changed by the Board of Commissioners.
Yes, ma'am. Madam Chair, I was just going to start and give you a little background. As you know, Glenn County does have 2 planning commissions, and then based on the matter before each of those planning commissions, some of those matters have to go to the Board of Commissioners. We also support the Zoning Board of Appeals. And so staff-wise, any given month, we have over 40 deadlines we have to meet to require legal ad placement, posting the property, sending out joint property owner letters, sending the agenda, getting packets out, et cetera. And with our current staffing levels, meeting those 40 deadlines a month was becoming difficult and was allowing some room for error. So the Board of Commissioners at their work session in April asked me to move forward with still planning staff levels at full staff, moving to only 1 of the planning commission meetings meeting each month. And so the county attorney's office has drawn that up, and that's what's before you this evening, and Mr. Worley can explain that to you. Thank you.
Good evening, commissioners. I'm going to get up on this mic. I've been told that I'm hard to hear. The planning commission ordinance, which is contained in the code of ordinances, separate and apart from your zoning ordinance, specifies that the planning commission shall meet at least once each month. So in order to change the schedule, we have to do an ordinance amendment to change that provision. Because we don't know how long that schedule of every other month will go on, rather than put a specific schedule in the ordinance, what we've done is we've said that the schedule will be set by the Board of Commissioners. They will do that by resolution, and we have a resolution prepared to go to the Board of Commissioners that if this ordinance amendment is approved for the remainder of 2017, they will set the meeting schedule for both the Islands Planning Commission and the Mainland Planning Commission. The Islands Planning Commission would meet, I believe, June, August, October, and December of 2017. And then in December of this year, the Board of Commissioners would set the schedule for the following year, or whatever length of time they decide to do. Another thing that we did while we had this ordinance amended, there have been some questions sometimes about how many votes are necessary to transact business. The Board of Commissioners ordinance specifies 4 votes, and so we just changed this to reflect that as well.
Ask a question, please, of the staff. I don't know what thinking went into this, but the Island Planning meets on the third Tuesday, which in December this year is December 18th, and we run right into the Christmas season and travel. The Mainland meets on the first Tuesday, and it would seem like maybe we ought to change that around so that the Planning Commission, the Mainland, would meet in December, and the Island Planning Commission would have its last meeting under this schedule in November.
Yes, sir. Under the proposed calendar that we're going to put forward to the commission, so that those advertising deadlines don't overlap, I'm actually going to request that each commission meet the third Tuesday of the month, because if Mainland keeps meeting the first Tuesday of the month, then we would still run into the issue of overlapping deadlines. So we will work with you all to set a holiday schedule for November and December.
Mr. Worley, I was under the impression that we would not meet again until July. So that schedule, you just said we would meet in June and then skip July and August. Is that correct? But I did see some documentation that we would not meet again until July. So I can't find it now, but I've seen the schedule earlier.
Maybe Pam can answer that better. It's always been my impression that y'all would meet in June. I think one of the reasons is the earliest this can go to the Board of Commissioners is the first meeting in June. By the time that happened, we would have already had our deadline for whether to advertise for y'all's meeting in June. So that if we didn't have y'all meet in June, then we wouldn't know in time whether to advertise.
And I was just looking to take a month off.
True.
And Commissioners, one other thing I wanted to bring up, this is not substantive to the ordinance itself, but as Ms. Watson mentioned, this is our first meeting with the new public comment policy. However, that public comment policy doesn't cover, the ordinance amendment that's before you tonight is to the code ordinances, and that ordinance requires a public hearing before the Board of Commissioners, but not the Planning Commission, and it's also not covered by your public comment policy. So unless y'all wanted to vote to have a public comment on that, which you could do, this would not be subject to your public comment policy.
Thank you. Any questions for staff?
I have a question. I'm sure you've thought quite a lot about this because you have to do it there every day, but in terms of the workload then that becomes necessary on each agenda, are you going to be able to manage the requests from applicants to keep the agendas manageable?
The thought we put into it to this point is that right now we are always working on both agendas simultaneously. So we will right now, what we will do is shift from focusing on just the mainland to then just the island, and staff resources should be adequate to handle that. If we get to application loads where it becomes cumbersome for you all to consider any one agenda at a time, then I would bring that to y'all to set some parameters for setting your agenda to make the time, the meeting time, manageable.
Madam Chairman, I have a question. Will, if you can help us out, the amendment has two issues that you pointed out, talks to the schedule, and then also the issue of majority required or four votes required to transact business. We found ourselves in an earlier meeting this year where we had enough, we had the quorum in order to have a meeting, five people, but we couldn't get muster four votes. So can we decouple this requirement and save that for further discussion?
Commissioner Duncan, you absolutely can. While we already have this ordinance amendment drafted, we thought we would put it in there, but if y'all are not ready to consider that right now, then that can be, if you move this forward, we can take that part of the amendment out.
Okay. I certainly would be in favor of taking that out. So that we could, if we did have a quorum of five and we had three members that voted for something, we could still move forward with conducting the business. So I would like to see that as well removed. The other thing I would like to see as part of the motion that goes forward to the Board of Commissioners is I would like for them to go ahead and amend our bylaws. Would be Article 3, Article 2, meetings, Section 201, regular meetings. In there, it says that the Planning Commission, the Islands Planning Commission, third Tuesday of each month. And so I think they ought to change the bylaws for the mainland and the Island Planning Commission as well in that section. So that we don't have a conflict.
I'd like to see the four votes required to approve any act.
Sorry, Commissioner, you'd like to keep that in this amendment?
Yes.
No.
So, Madam Chair, on the IPC and the mainland commission bylaws, you're suggesting that they just be changed to be consistent with this and not, no other changes?
No other change, just to be consistent with the ordinance amendment being proposed.
Thank you.
That would be part of the motion that goes forward. Any other discussion on this topic, this ordinance amendment? Chair will entertain a motion.
And you're not going to allow public comments on this?
No one has made a motion to say anything about it.
I wish someone would.
I'll make a motion for that to allow public comment.
Is there a second? Motion fails. So
I move to approve the amendment as presented.
Is there a second?
A second.
Any further discussion? The amendment is presented. presented. I would like to see, as part of the motion, that the bylaws be changed to comport with the ordinance amendment. I think that should be part of our motion as well.
Chair, are you suggesting that be added as an amendment to the motion?
Well, we're in discussion. I would like to see that part of the motion. But I think you have some. We're still in discussion. We have a motion and a second discussion.
Yeah, Madam Chairman, I would just like to talk about this issue. There are two separate points in this amendment, not necessarily related. I'm not sure why they got drawn up this way. I would prefer we not include the issue of four votes being required, and we take that up as a separate meaningful discussion. Obviously, because of the staff, staffing levels and resource issues, we do need to consider the schedule that they propose.
Any other discussion? Yes, sir.
If an amendment is in order, I would recommend that we amend the original motion to include revision to the bylaws to incorporate the change in the ordinance.
I agree to that.
Does the second agree?
Yes.
Okay, so we have a motion to approve by the amendment as presented, and to also add that the bylaws be amended to comport with the proposed amendment. All those in favor?
I'm sorry, Madam Chair, if I could interject. I think you need a vote on your motion to amend first.
Thank you. Okay. Vote on the motion to amend. Even though you amended the motion, or amended the second, we need a vote.
So if y'all approve the motion to amend, then that will be incorporated into the original motion, and then you can take a vote on that.
Okay. Then we need to all those in favor of amending the motion in the second, raise your right hand. Opposed?
I'm for it.
Is that unanimous? Okay. So now I can take a vote. Okay. So all those in favor of the amended motion, please raise your right hand. 3, 4, 5, 5, 4, opposed, 2. Motion passes. Okay. Our next item is preliminary plat, PP3402, Sinclair. Consider preliminary plat approval for a 245-lot subdivision at 1900, 1960, and 2170 Lawrence Road. The property consists of, not just yet, please keep the lights up just for a few more minutes, please, while I read this. Thank you. The property consists of 128.853 undeveloped acres and is zoned plan development. Parcel IDs 04-14278, 04-11390, and 04-00207. OCLS, agent for SLFIVGA, Sinclair LLC, and St. Simon Sinclair Reserve Plantation LLC, applicants and owners. I believe Mr. Worley has a comment.
Yes, Commissioners, before you consider this item, I would suggest that you adjourn to executive session to discuss potential litigation.
Okay. Is there a motion to go into executive session for potential litigation?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor of the motion, raise your right hand. All those opposed? Okay, so it's 6-1. Into executive session. We're now going into executive session.
And then, members, I think we have a room to use that we can use. So the public can stay and we can go.
All right.
Make a motion to come out of executive session.
All those in favor of coming back into the meeting, closing? All those in favor? Mr. Okay, that's unanimous. No action. We're going to read the item again. PB 3402 Sinclair, consider preliminary plat approval for a 245-lot subdivision at 1900, 1960, and 2170 Lawrence Road. The property consists of 128.853 undeveloped acres in the zone plan development. Parcel IDs 04-14278, 04-11390, and 04-00207. OCL Best Agent for SLF, the 4th Georgia Sinclair LLC, and Sanctifying Sinclair Reserve Plantation LLC, applicants and owners. Staff report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Please bear with us one moment while we get our technology working. Outlined in red, located on Lawrence Road. Property address 1900, 1960, and 2170 Lawrence Road, approximately 128.85 acres. This is a planned development. The existing land use is undeveloped. The proposed land use is a single family subdivision, and the number of lots indicated on the preliminary plat is 245. The zoning information that you see in your staff report is all on the screen. It's from the plan development text. They are not proposing any patio or townhome lots, and so that's why those dimensions are grayed out in the report. This is the subject property looking from Lawrence Road. It's the wooded area on the top photo to the right, and the bottom photo is on Lawrence Road, subject properties to the left. As we reviewed last month, this has a long and time history going back to 2008 when the Planned Development District was originally established for 82 acres. Another 60 acres was added to that planned development text. So the two parcels together comprise the entire 128-acre tract. The plat was originally submitted in November of 2016. And in November of 23rd, 2016, approximately 60 acres of the 120 acres were conveyed to St. Simon Sinclair Plantation Reserve, and the application was modified to reflect that change of ownership. In 2012, the PD amendment included some additional provisions, including a 25-foot buffer along the northern, western, and southern boundaries, consistent with the buffers described in the PD text, a 75-foot buffer along the eastern boundary of the property. The townhome and estate lots were added to this amendment, and there was also a maximum number of 250 units allowed in the plan development text that could be placed on the southern portion of the tract, which is indicated here by the red line. The plat indicates 90 lots plus a portion of 5 lots on their current plat, so they are under that 100 lot delineation from the PD text. This is the full preliminary plat. We'll walk quickly through the items required for a preliminary plat. And in just a moment, I will highlight a few of the changes that have been made since we heard this application last month. The name of the subdivision, the ownership information, developer information, the vicinity map, north arrow, et cetera.
the required certifications for the plat. The plat does include two additional sheets so that you can see the information in more detail. This includes the boundary lines as well as the proposed layout for the subdivision. As we discussed at the last meeting, the natural features are shown on here as well. The wetlands have been delineated and submitted to the Corps of Engineers, but the Corps of Engineers verification has not been received to my knowledge, but the natural features are indicated here. They have also indicated the cultural features based on discussion at the first IPC meeting. They have added the cultural resources on the property, which include the tabby ruins and the graves, et cetera. The existing connection point for utilities is shown here. The names of the owners adjacent to the property are also indicated as required. They've indicated the FEMA information as required. And also the building setback information. Our ordinance requires that oddly shaped lots, that the setback lines are indicated on those lots, and the plat on the detail pages indicate the setback lines for all of the lots. We also received a letter from Five Rivers Conservation Group in support of the preliminary plat application, as well as additional information provided by Thomas and Hutton following the initial hearing of this preliminary plat application before the IPC. As a reminder, the zoning, when the PD district was established, sets forth the density that is allowed, as well as the development standards such as setbacks, etc. The preliminary plat is a tentative subdivision plat and does not create any new lots. New lots would not be created until they continue in the process. The next step would be the subdivision construction plans for the installation of the infrastructure. The final plat would need to be approved by the Board of Commissioners before the lots are created. The preliminary plat does indicate two phases for the project, and as noted on the plat, phase two is under a conservation easement. Since the IPC meeting, there have been a couple of modifications that have been made. In particular, note number 22 provides more specificity regarding any potential trail development and articulates that a trail cannot be built in the buffer on the southern border of the property. Note 23 adds additional information regarding the buffer along Lawrence Road and the composition of that buffer. The Atlantic Coast Conservancy, which is the holder of the conservation easement, has also added their name to the application as a holder of the conservation easement and has authorized PC Best as their agent for these proceedings. And you've also received a letter provided by Joint Water and Sewer that states that this area does not currently have capacity, but it's anticipated that capacity will be available around July of this year. These are the notes to highlight the changes. Again, note number 21 states that the property within phase two of the development is in a conservation easement and provides the deed of preference. Note number 22 has been modified. No trails or walking paths will be constructed within the buffer along the rear property lines of lots 13 through 19 or the side property line of lot 20. And note number 23 states, in addition to the buffer requirements as set forth in Section 10 of the amended Sinclair Plan Development District, the 75-foot wide buffer along Lawrence Road shall provide a combination of existing plant material, new plant material, and or berms as necessary to effectively screen all residential homes on the lots that are adjacent to Lawrence Road from view from Lawrence Road. Complete and effective landscape screening along lots 8 and 9 may be limited due to the existing overhead electrical power line and drainage ditch. This is an exhibit to more clearly delineate the phases. Phase one is in white and phase two is in yellow, and that's the area that is covered under the conservation easement. The these are your possible motions to approve the application, to approve the application subject to any necessary modifications, to disapprove the preliminary plat or any portion thereof based on its failure to comply with specific sections of our subdivision regulations, or to defer the application. Any questions for staff? Is the applicant present? Welcome again.
Good evening. Madam Chair, members of the Island Planning Commission, my name is O.C. Best. I'm a partner at Stratford Land, and we're here tonight asking respectfully for approval by preliminary plat, City Clerk. Be happy to try to answer any questions you might have, so I'll make myself available for those questions.
Any questions for the applicant?
Thank you.
I guess I'll ask the question.
Oh, okay.
He came all this way.
Sure.
This is a very interesting chain of title in this project and in project design, and we've been trying to get a clear understanding of exactly why this is for us in the way it is. Could you just give us a thumbnail from your folks' goals and objectives? What are we looking at here, please?
We're looking at an application for a preliminary plat for 128 acres for 245 lots, co-owned by our company, SLF4 Sinclair, and the other company being St. Simon Sinclair Reserve, over which a portion of the property has been conserved. And we put forth that preliminary plat application in accordance with the Glynn County regulations and guidelines.
What is the corporate relationship between Sinclair and the Atlantic Coast Conservancy?
St. Simon Sinclair Reserve is the owner of the property over which the conservation easement exists today. The easement's been recorded. The Atlantic Coast Conservation is the easement holder over that conservation easement.
And is there a proper relationship between them?
I don't know.
A couple of the documents we were given were signed by Five Rivers. What is the relationship between Five Rivers and the ACC?
Five Rivers is the parent company of St. Simon Sinclair.
Madam Chair, may I ask a question?
Sure.
I have yet to see a traffic study or a letter from the Army Corps of Engineers. I'm just curious, have you provided the county with that?
We've provided the county with a traffic study that was approved by the county engineer. And we have made a submittal to the Army Corps of Engineers for a nationwide permit for a very small wetland impact that we have to make for one of the roadways to provide 2 points of access.
But you've not gotten any approval yet?
No.
Any other questions for the applicant? Any other questions? Okay, thank you very much. We appreciate it. We now have a new public policy comment period. So we're going to open up the floor for public comment. All those who want to speak in favor of the application, please come forward. To speak in favor of the application, please state your name if you represent anyone.
I'm Alan Burns, and I'm property owner of the butts of Southern End. So I'm very pleased that that OC has gone ahead and basically sealed that off from any bike trails in there. And that is something that we were very concerned about, is maintaining that buffer where it was opaque and did provide what a buffer should be doing. And I strongly request that the commission consider amending your ordinances to where a buffer is a buffer, not a recreational area, as was originally laid out in this, because that does not provide protection for adjacent property owners. So he has worked with us on that, and we do appreciate that. Thank you
very much. Anyone want to come forward and speak in favor of this application? Hearing none, seeing none, we'll move to the portion of the public comment period. Anyone wants to speak against the project?
I'm Julian Smith. I live on St. Simon's Island. The description of this application on the agenda states, consider preliminary plat approval for a 245-lot subdivision on 128.8 acres. Now that sounds very generous, an average of more than half an acre for each lot. But let's look at the breakdown of these nearly 129 acres. 28.6 acres are to be left undeveloped for future development, whatever that means. 20.3 acres will be taken up by roads and rights of way. That leaves 80 acres for lots, which means an average of less than a third of an acre per lot, with some lots larger and some smaller. We are told on one document that there will be 29 state lots, 99 standard lots, and 122 village lots, which totals 250 lots instead of 245. I'm sure there's an explanation of that somewhere, but I couldn't find it. And here's something curious. On sheets 2 and 3, and 3 of 3, in one set of preliminary plats, all 250 of the lots are marked B for village. Is that a mistake? Or are the applicants trying to keep their options open to make room for McMansions in each lot? I ask that because the minimum side yard setback for a village lot is 5 feet. In terms of how much space is left for McMansions on these lots, let's consider that there are large live oak trees on some of those lots, and in some cases more than one large live oak. If you look closely at Exhibit B, that multicolored illustrated concept plan dated 2012, you will see the plan provides faint dimensions for some of the large live oaks, and that there are multiple large live oaks on some lots with straddling the lot lines. I mention that to give context to the tree protection statement on pages 20 and 21 of the 25-page document titled Plan Development District Zoning Amendment, dated 2012. Quote, the Sinclair tract is populated, interesting term populated, it's populated by numerous large live oak trees. Accordingly, all healthy, structurally sound live oak trees, 24 inches DBH or greater, shall be preserved and protected by the following methods. Those methods include designation of those large live oaks on the site plan submitted for approval. And here comes the bottom line in what this means. All, quote, all designated live oaks shall be preserved in as much as reasonable and practical. I'll say that again. All designated live oaks shall be preserved inasmuch as reasonable and practical. Could the applicants introduce the reasonable and practical person who will make this decision? Or will the decision about what is reasonable or practical be left to each property owner or to their contractors, etc.? I think that this application crowds too many houses, too many lots, too many roads on land that has some significant oak trees that should be marked for preservation, period. Period. Not one what is reasonable or practical. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to speak against the project? The preliminary plat as presented? Hearing none, seeing none, the public comment period is closed. Do we have a discussion? Any discussion?
I just feel that there are some things missing and inaccurate in this plat and this application. I feel like it's incomplete and should not be before us tonight.
Madam Chairman, I move to disapprove the preliminary plat and any portion thereof based on its failure to comply with the requirements of Section 703 of the Blaine County Subdivision Regulations. And I'll speak to the motion.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion?
Among many other things, such as Ms. Kate mentioned about the incomplete application, it is clear that sewer service is not available to the development at the present time as required by Section 703. In addition, in order for us to properly consider this application, the county needs to provide the Island Planning Commission with an independent professional analysis of the impact of the proposed development on streets and roads of St. Simon Valley. The analysis should include the projected 2,500 daily trips from this project, the projected daily trips from approved projects not yet developed, existing traffic on the island, and the potential emergency evacuation of the islands. The IPC can then make an informed decision.
Any other discussion?
Yes. Ms. Thompson, you've told us on numerous occasions that you would not provide any preliminary plat or site plan applications if they were not compliant with the county ordinances. Is this application compliant with our ordinances as they are today?
Yes, sir. County staff has determined that based on the requirements for preliminary plat, that this application is complete.
Thank you.
Madam Chairman, I believe we're also told that plat cannot be before us, that where joint water and sewer state that they cannot provide taps to the applicant. And while they are saying that they will be at a future date, at this time, it is not available, correct?
They have a letter in your packet that they have provided that their policy on preliminary plats, which is a concept design, is that they will say okay with comments if capacity is not available today, but it's available at date certain. And in the letter in your packet, they do say that area is over capacity today, and they have a date that they have estimated capacity to be available, and that's in your packet.
They state it may be available.
Yes, sir. That's their estimated time of when it may be available.
And
yes,
we've seen how reliable their estimates are in the past, too, haven't we?
That's their letter to you, to provide your information to make your decision this evening.
I know.
So by their own letter, by their own admission, they are admitting that the water is their capacity at this time.
Yes, ma'am. The letter does say that.
Ms. Thompson, regarding your response to Commissioner Willis regarding the plat, now reviewing the staff memo, items 9, 10, and 12 are unlike the other items. They are not marked compliant. all of the other items are our compliance, so does that mean that they're not compliant, or what does that mean when there's nothing that's said?
Mr. Meadows, thank you for pointing that out. What is provided in your packet is the entire review history, so it's every time each discipline reviewed it. So non-compliant is shown each time until they are either okay or okay with comments.
This is the cover memo, not the review history. The cover memo that shows the comments in the shaded, page 7.
Okay, sir, ask your question again.
Items 9, 10, and 12 do not indicate to the commission that these items are compliant. All of the other items say they are compliant. So
our check mark is put beside that number to show that we've verified it's compliant. It doesn't have the word compliant because we provided a little more information to clarify the issues such as natural features. We let you know that the wetlands were shown and have been sent to be verified by the Army Corps, but have not yet been verified. Which they don't have to be verified wetlands for preliminary. Any other discussion or comments? I'd like to give the applicant an opportunity if you want to speak about anything.
Madam Chair, members of the IPC, on the sewer study, we do understand that capacity is not there today for this project. But the way we understand the process works is once you have a preliminary plat, then you go to the Joint Water Sewer Authority and negotiate whatever improvements are necessary in order to connect your project to the overall city wastewater system, which is what the plans do. And we believe that the letter provided by Joint Water and Sewer say exactly that. They also said that our plat meets their requirements for engineering standards for the for our project. So I think it's a timing issue rather than a complete or compliance issue on the water and the sewer. On the traffic study, we did provide a traffic study to the county, and we provided a traffic study that the county engineers asked us to do. We did. They reviewed it and they approved it. And I think that's all that we as an applicant to be asked to do. So we believe that we are compliant with traffic study requirements. I think that's it. Thank you.
Thank you. Can I ask a question? So in the negotiations with Joint Water and Sewer, do you plan on asking for 245 taps or 100?
We will ask them for taps in a phased development. The exact phases haven't yet. We won't build all the units on it.
I think the answer to the question that you really was asking is you do not intend to build 245 lots as shown on the plan.
Yeah, I believe in our last public hearing, we mentioned that we only intend to build 120 or 245 lots.
But we're being asked to approve
that plat 245. Preliminary plat 245. Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Could you tell us why you're doing that? Why you're applying for 245 and only doing 120?
Yeah, it's for the conservation easement, Commissioner Humphreys. For the conservation easement purposes, we need to establish the entitlements for the entire property, both for zoning as well as for subdivision. We have zoning for 250 lots by our plan development zoning, and the preliminary plat will provide the entitlements for subdivision for the entire 250 lots.
Yeah, I guess I just don't understand why that. I mean, it
It's part of conservation easement. Well, it's part of conservation easement law, and I would recommend or suggest that you consult with your county attorney on that issue. It's a legal issue. It's over my head at this point.
I believe you told us previously that it was to establish value for the conservation easement.
That's correct.
That's why you're having a preliminary plat showing so many lots.
That's correct.
I believe you just indicated you would up 120 lots. And can you explain to us, is the area in phase one, is that the same legal description as in the PD text that's limited to 100 lots?
No, sir.
No, it's not.
No, sir. The original zoning for this property had a planned development zoning on the north side of the property, the north two-thirds, if you will. And the southern part of the property was straight zoning. We revised the PD to include all of the property into the planned development zoning, so we have a consistent plan of development for the entire property. At that time, the southern part that's referenced in the zoning was an east-west line that was just north of the existing lake. So in the motion to approve the new PD zoning, the commissioners did not want lots on the south part of that, the original line, which doesn't exist anymore. They didn't want any more than 100 lots below that area. So that line doesn't have anything to do with the new phase lines today.
How many lots will be developed in the phase two area?
Phase two area on the preliminary plat has 120.
How many will be created? Constructed, built, or turned on?
In the phase two area?
Yes.
Zero.
None.
Yes, sir.
So the reserved rights that are retained in the conservation easement, those will not be developed either?
The lots in the conservation easement area are not intended to be developed, to be constructed.
I'm talking about the lot reserved in the easement itself.
In the easement itself, it talks about several lots being reserved. I think there's one homestead lot being reserved for a caretaker type of structure. I believe that's the only structure being reserved in the conservation.
Any other questions for the applicant? Thank you again.
Thank you.
Any more discussion?
Madam Chair, I'm just support the motion that's on the table. In my own review of all of these materials, I looked pretty hard at it. I looked at the requirements of the county ordinances and the subdivision ordinance, including where it requires us to, or the applicant, to provide the preliminary plat and the supporting documents. In my opinion, the supporting documents includes substantial information that is required under 703 and 704 that are not present on the plat that I've seen. And that's one of the reasons I'll be supporting the motion. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Are you ready to vote, Commissioner?
Restate the motion.
Okay, the motion, which has been seconded, is to deny the preliminary plat for Sinclair Tract pursuant to Section 703. That's the motion. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. All those opposed? Motion passes.
This is another view of the property. There is a public beach access to the right. This is the structure that is across the street from the proposed development. This is the structure that is immediately adjacent to the current structure. And these two structures are located adjacent to the end that you just saw. So those are the three structures that are alongside the current proposed development on Hostel Avenue. This is the plat, which indicates the parcel proposed for the redevelopment with the site plan. This is the proposed site plan, which I will again walk through each of the required items. This is the basic information, including the project owner, applicant, etc. The dates and revision dates. The information pertaining to the development area and development standards. This is the proposed layout for the new condo building. I will take a moment to point out a couple of things to you here. The dark shaded area, that's the building footprint. They are proposing to place the majority of their parking underneath the structure. They are required to have 12 parking spaces, so they have some of their parking that's under the structure and an additional four spaces that are here as you come into the property, but not underneath the structure. So they have met their parking requirement. Currently, there's public parking here on Hostel Avenue. They are proposing to relocate one of these parking spaces for their entrance driveway, which is here, which centers the drive onto the property so they can access the parking underneath. So it's not the removal of a public parking space, it's shifting that parking space over. This is their development setback line as required to be shown on their site plan. Information regarding the building footprint and overhangs also shown on the site plan, along with their refuse collection area. Their landscape plan, they are proposing to plant two live oaks and a crepe myrtle in order to meet their tree quality points. Again, this shows the off-street parking as well. They are proposing underground detention for their stormwater management. And they've also indicated where they will connect to the public utilities. These are the building elevations as submitted with the site plan application. And your possible motions are to approve the application subject to any necessary modifications, deny the site plan based on failure to comply with specific sections in the ordinance, or defer the application. Happy to answer any questions. Questions for staff?
The applicant recently applied for abandonment of some roadways and all, and it was denied by the county commission. Is any of these buildings or any appurtenances or parking encroaching on those lands that were lost to the sea and now trying to bring them back again?
No, sir. It's all within their existing property lines.
Is there any infringement on the public parking in this area? Because I go by there quite often and it's a very popular public parking. It's very easy access. It's much closer to the border than a lot of the other accesses, and that I wouldn't like to see any infringement of the public parking.
They have proposed to relocate the space, but not to decrease or take away the public parking. So that the amount of public parking that's there currently today will remain the same.
And the public can still park along the streets there?
Yes, sir. That's a very wide right of way there. I think it's 100 feet. And so that's how the county is able to add public parking in the right of way.
The public has public parking down next to the King and Prince. Is there any signage, anything to make that known that that is available to the public?
I believe there are currently signs at this location that indicate it's public work. I can go back to the photographs.
If there's not, that's no, I would think that would be good.
We can certainly check and verify that.
And my final question is that they're including, and this is, I really don't know, they're shown offices, and I have to believe those are additional sleeping areas. Is there any way that we can limit or make sure that we don't create another party house type atmosphere where you're going to have, you know, many, many people crashing on these things and have a lot of parking and parking problems? Is there any way we can try to control the number of people that can sleep at these places?
They have met the number of rooms that they're allowed based on our definition of a sleeping room. One recommendation or one action you could include in your motion would be the, I believe two of the units have an office that you might be referencing.
Yes. All units do, and it does.
I believe the upstairs units, those are bedrooms, and the two lower units, those are, there's a, two of the units are one bedroom with the offices, and then the other units are two bedrooms. But the units that have the offices do not have a door, and they also only have a half bath. So those could be framed in a way where a door could not be added on after the fact to help address the issue of whether or not there's a door.
All the units have an office.
They may, sir.
I'm interested in those. How you phrase where we could control the numbers of people that would stay there.
Mr. Humphreys, to add to the answer for your question, we did verify that the offices, as shown on the plans, do not meet our definition of a sleeping room. That being said, we're open to work with the attorney or the applicant to somehow ensure definite compliance with that.
That's what I want.
Okay.
Could someone read the definition of sleeping room?
Are there any other comments or questions for staff?
I have one.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, it states here that the existing drive will be demolished and replaced with a new drive. But then when I look over on the area where it says review history, it says existing parking on Hostel Avenue can't be removed for new driveway. Internal traffic pattern will be tight. Drive aisles is less than 24 feet. And also it says parking will encroach into conserved root zone and tree protection zone. So, my other one is right here. It states a proposed stormwater system. It says underground detention. But then when I look over the area where it says review history, it states that infiltration tests will be required to ensure the underground detention system functions.
Yes, ma'am. Your first question about the access drive and the parking, an earlier version of their site plan indicated removal of one of the parking spaces, and so they modified their site plan to address that. So the comments that you see, these date all the way back to the original submission. There's been several revisions since then. and engineering did sign off on the dimensions for the drive out and the location of the driveway, as well as the relocation of the one parking space within the public right-of-way. With regards to your questions about the underground detention, that information and the drainage calculations and additional testing, et cetera, will be required as part of the building permit application.
Okay, because I see this was dated as of May 9th, 2017.
That's when it was printed out, the review comments. Any other questions for staff? Yes.
Regarding item 9 in the staff report about the water supply and sewage, there's a note later on down in the comments regarding a connection to the water project. Could you explain that?
That was the letter from Joint Water and Sewer.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, sir. The letter from Joint Water and Sewer. The upgrades, it's within the same basin as the Guar project, and so the upgrades to that basin will also address this project. And I did ask for clarification from Joint Water and Sewer whether or not they were related, and I think that reference to Guar is somewhat is confusing, because I had the same question. It's because they're in the same basin, and so it's the same upgrades that are proposed for.
So we understand then that once that upgrade has been done, then there will be capacity for lifts. Is that
yes,
what you're trying to tell us?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
But once again, in the letter provided by Joint Water Sewer, by their own terminology, the proposed development site lies within a sewer collection basin that is currently classified as being over capacity, correct?
Correct.
And an additional upgrade may be necessary.
Yes, sir.
So there's no capacity available right now because it's already over capacity.
On this date, correct.
Okay. Any other questions for staff?
I have a question. Mine deals with the parking. On the last sheet of the site plan, it shows 6 public parking spaces currently. On the first sheet of the documents you have, the site plan, sheet 1, it shows 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, more than half of the 6 parking spot is in the driveway. So I'm not understanding how they're telling us that we're not losing a parking space. Well, over here is the last page of this, of the shows existing parking spaces, and it's got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 spaces, 6 public parking spaces on the last sheet here. Okay? Then we go to the first sheet, and we now have 5 public parking spaces. And part of what is called the 6th one is taken up the driveway. So I don't understand how you can say we're not losing a parking space, public parking space.
The applicant may be able to provide some clarification, and they did have in an earlier version of their application 2 parking spaces shown on the opposite side of the space, I believe. I'm going to clarify one thing.
Well, wait. Well, it looks to me like one of the parking spaces.
I'm sorry, I misspoke, Madam Chair. The spaces that are on the current, the last sheet, the site plan?
Yes. Those are the current
Yes, ma'am. That last one, the last one where the driveway is shown, it looks like a parking space, but it's actually not. That's where the asphalt ends within the right-of-way, but that's actually the access to the driveway, so that's actually not a parking space. There's only 5 spaces there currently. And it's just where it changes the surface from asphalt into the gravel for the driveway.
So you're saying that last space is not space?
Correct. That's access to the driveway.
Interesting.
Thank you for asking for clarification.
Interesting. It's just that they show in the driveway one of the spaces, and that's the space they're moving.
The
okay.
Yes, ma'am. The in the site plan, that space that's kind of half in and half out is the one that's being replaced by the new one that's on the beach access.
Okay.
Side.
Thank you for clarifying that for me, because I thought there were six, and then this other two.
Yes, ma'am. It's easy to see.
Also, have kind of a question on the ownership issue. On sheet one, it shows the ownership as the Gentiles and Gentile properties, and the applicant being TerraCap. But then on sheet three, it shows the owner as TerraCap. So sheet four, so I didn't quite understand who owns what and who's the, you know. I mean, is TerraCap actually an owner?
On the application form, they are.
On sheet three.
Yes, ma'am.
Plan.
Yes, ma'am. I see the reference.
Right, sheet one says the owner is the Gentiles and Gentile properties, and the applicant being TerraCap. And then on sheet three, it shows the owner as TerraCap. So I was a little confused by that. If you could clarify that for me.
According to the application, the owners are John and Diana Gentile.
Right,
the applicant.
I think sheet three says the owner is TerraCap.
Yes, ma'am, and as
the owner developer on sheet three is TerraCap, right? Well, that's not correct, correct? I mean, that's not correct.
Currently, to our knowledge, but I anticipate that the applicant, that those are plans that are being prepared to accompany the building permit, and at that time, TerraCap will be the owner. Is what, but again, the applicant could speak better.
On sheet four, it shows, they're going to replace a 2-inch water line with an 8-inch water line on Pastel. Who's going to be replacing that, do you know?
The applicant, this is my understanding from speaking with Joint Water and Sewer. Joint Water and Sewer had some requested some upgrades to the infrastructure in order to provide the necessary infrastructure for the project.
Okay, I have another question. On these sheets here, sheet what's called sheet six. What is the height? They show the height up here is, of the entire building is being 44 feet. So how high is the roof? Is the roof like, because if you look at these numbers along the left, it's 9 feet, 4 inches, 10 feet. You add those up, those are 39 feet, 4 inches, which would make the roof 4 feet, 6 inches. But if you add up these other up along this side over here, that comes to like it's like 16 3/4. Those come to 43.5 feet, and the roof would be 1.5 feet. Do you know how tall the roof is actually supposed to be? We're trying to get a relationship because they show the 45 feet coming to the, you know, their line comes in the center of the ground floor.
The discrepancy, I believe, is from where the height is measured based on mean sea level. So if you'll look at the lower portion of the dimension line that shows the overall height, you'll see it's above the ground level. So that's why the numbers don't necessarily seem to add up.
I just wonder how tall the roof's going to be, how tall, you know, compared to the buildings. But it's all going to be 44 feet.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, okay. Sounds good. Okay, I don't think I have any more questions.
I was the agent for this project. Tracy Morton from my office will be presenting this tonight. She's my associate. She's also an architect.
Thank you. I also mentioned we have Jonathan Roberts from Roberts Civil Engineering. and Bert Etheridge.
Could you speak up, please?
Yes, Jonathan and Bert from Jonathan Roberts, Civil Engineering. To address any civil questions. So.
Okay. Any questions for the applicant?
To follow up on Desiree's point, what is your starting point of construction?
Approximate starting point for construction would be 3 to 4 months.
Well, I meant like ground level, where
how many FEMA feet up do you need?
Oh, you're the building height. So the building, you were asking about the roof height. The roof height is approximately 7 feet.
7 feet.
And the overall roof height is measured from the required flood elevation height, which is why that line is up high.
Right, so what starting point are you guys?
How many
feet up?
It is approximately 6 feet up. I don't have it written on.
So the first level floor is 6 feet up?
No, your first floor level is 9 feet 4 inches off the parking level.
No, ground floor will be 6 feet fill. You have to put in 6 feet of fill to get to your ground, to start your ground level?
No.
Okay.
So, no, the parking level will be 8 to 12 inches above the existing grade.
Okay.
And that'll be on a slab.
So you'll start grade.
Right. And then from there up, that first living level is 9 feet,
right.
4 inches
right.
above that.
So then totaling that up all the way to the top is what? Can you walk me through that?
If you're totaling all the way from the bottom,
it would be the 44 feet plus 12 feet buildup, right?
It's approximately 44 plus 6, about 50 feet
50.
Above,
right,
above the ground level. We're required to measure from 13 feet mean sea level.
Right, okay. So. Okay.
This is zoned by FEMA BE 16, correct?
Yes, it is.
Meaning?
It's in 15 and 19, but you measure from 13.
Not 16.
Not 16. It is in the zoning ordinance that you measure from 13.
Can you clarify for us the issue of the owner applicant? I believe they were saying on sheet one, I noticed the owner, this is Gentiles and Gentile Properties, and the applicant is Terracat. And then on sheet three, we have owner Terracat.
Okay. So to clarify, the information at this date on page one is the correct information. The owner is Don Gentile and Diane, and the applicant is Terracat. And at the date that construction was to start, the owner would then be Terracat. But the information on page one is correct today.
Okay. And will you be replacing the, will the owner be replaced? I don't know who's going to replace. Are you going to replace the 2-inch line that goes into the 8-inch line?
The applicant will be replacing that.
Be replacing that. Okay. That's all the questions I have.
So that question. So just to clarify, it was 44 and some odd plus the 7 for the roof, is that correct?
Yes.
And it is
no, 44 includes the roof.
Yeah, 44 includes the roof, and below the 13 feet, and you said sea level was
right.
An additional 6 feet.
Right. I'll just clarify. Okay.
Did we understand that? This is a relocated parking space that's going to go partly into the public access way.
Okay, and again, let me clarify that driveway, that part that Madam Chair referred to is the existing access drive. So right next to that, to get our driveway, we need it to be to enter the building. We're removing the one spot and we're moving it over the dark shaded area to the other side of the drive. So, in essence, we are not losing any parking spaces, any public parking spaces. Does that answer your question?
My question was really more about the public walkway to the beach. Is the parking lot going to interfere with the public walking way?
Oh, no.
That's some distance from the... That's about 3 or 4 car lengths over.
Right.
The walkway from the property.
It's well out of the way.
It's not like 3 car lengths, 3 or 4.
At least.
As part of the construction design, do you think the applicant might be willing to work with the county to do some upgrades of the entrance to the public access way, which would be right adjacent to their property?
It's something that we could certainly talk with the owner, applicant, and consider. Commissioner Reynolds, I can speak to that briefly. I just actually spoke with a county engineer today. And the county has been meeting with the Coastal Resources Division of DNR to talk about longer-term improvements to that to try and address the beach encroachment that continually happens in that area for public access, where the sand continually comes up. So that's something the county is exploring.
Thank you. I had in mind this would be a great opportunity to do some aesthetic improvements, which would also contribute to the desirability of the project.
We're going to build a 6-foot wall there, 6-foot masonry wall, correct?
That's required at the front to provide, cover the view of the parking in the front. So that is a requirement that we're providing.
Okay, I'm still going back to the height because when I look at this here, I see 45 feet, which is just below the first one before. And then you have some remaining for the parking, which would go over the 45-foot limit.
That line where the 45-foot is marked is our 13 feet mean sea level. That is why it's measured from there. That's where we measure from.
Okay, so you're 45 on top of the 13.
Pardon?
You're 45 on top of the 13.
Yeah, the way the county measures, or
right,
the way the code is written, is they start at that MSL line when you measure up. Ask where the height is.
Because I was under the impression that would include the 45 foot, would include
from the MSL.
And I think one thing, Commissioner Kate, that may help clarify that where that 45 foot dimension shows on the elevations, that bottom line is the 13 foot mean sea level line, so it's not necessarily 13 feet from there down to the existing grade.
Correct. No, I know that because that's obvious, but I'm just saying that would be over the 45 foot requirement, even with just a little bit, a few feet on the full 13.
Yes, ma'am. Based on how we, our requirements for determining maximum height, a structure can be within our height requirement and from grade be taller than 45 feet.
One more question. What is your, Mr. Dowsey, what's your buffer between Myrtle Street? Myrtle Street, I don't see it on here.
Buffers are not required.
Okay, from any dunes or anything? To the left?
You've got that 6-foot wall.
Yeah, the only requirement is the masonry wall at the front of the property. Our zone.
So in your application to the DNR, they approved the plat that you presented?
They did, yes.
Okay. So that is not, I'm looking at that plat, is not the same plat that we're presenting with tonight. It doesn't appear.
The DNR plat asked us to remove the deck, which we, before any construction starts, so we've added a note that that deck that is out over the existing marker, that will be removed. And since then, I think there was a little extension of the pool deck that was no longer needed, so we took that off. I think the parking area in front is not within the DNR jurisdiction. So yes, we did alter the parking in the front so that we could keep every parking spot in the public area. So that would be another difference. But that area is not in the DNR jurisdiction, so.
I'm just looking at the beach and dune setback line. You have 20 feet on one you presented to the DNR. To the left?
We still have the same development setback line. 20
feet?
Yes, yes.
Should it not be 40 feet according to our BE zone requirements?
No.
25, 14, 40A, all new construction substantial improvements of existing structures shall be located at 40 feet landward of the most seaward stable dune.
That's if there's a dune, I believe. We do not have a dune.
It's an abutment. It's like a huge river.
We have a rock abutment. There's a rock abutment, but there is no dune.
Ordinary high water line is still there? Is that,
So the ordinary high water line is there, and then the setback off of that without a dune is the 20 feet. And the DNR plan should show the same.
So it's 20 feet on our plat. I just don't see it. I don't know.
Well, we've noted it, and it would scale properly.
Building setbacks?
The building setbacks are on.
It says side 15 feet.
Correct. That's the side setback.
The side setback.
Mm-hmm.
Which is not the same as what you submitted to DNR, which is 20 feet, correct?
The side setback to the DNR was also 15. The setbacks didn't change on the DNR application.
That's just not how I'm reading it.
I have a question on the landscape bed to the side next to the revetment. Did you have plan on some kind of screening of that parking area from the people that are at the beach? Underground parking area?
It'll be fully enclosed.
Oh, fully enclosed?
I mean, it may be like lattice, a wood lattice.
But it'll be something.
It'll be something. Just bringing those cars, right? And that's exactly.
Okay. All right. Any more questions for the applicant? Over staff? Okay. Well, thank you very much. Okay, we will now open the floor for a public comment period. All those wishing to speak in favor of the project, please come forward. And your name, sir?
My name is Bill Gustin, and I would definitely think that any project that Robert Vestry is going to put together is probably going to be a terrific project. I do have one question for the planning folks.
Well, you can direct your question to the chair, please?
I will ask the question to you, then.
Thank you.
How do we calculate parking spaces for this? It was my understanding that it was 1.5 spaces per sleeping room, which would add up to 15 spots, not 12. So I was just curious how you came to the conclusion of 12.
Okay. We will answer your question.
That's my question. Okay. Thank you.
Staff, could you please answer that question? How you calculated the sleeping room? And if it's different?
How may I?
Mr. Arthur, you want to respond to that?
If I may, Mary,
please.
I think I can help staff. These are condominiums, and the parking spaces are measured by the unit, not by the room. There's 6 units, 6 times 2 is 12. Mr. Gustin is referring to a hotel or something like that. It's 1.5 or like a bed and breakfast, perhaps. It's 1.5 per sleeping room. That's the difference.
Okay. Thank you. All right, thank you. Anyone else who speak in favor of the application?
Hearing none, seeing none. Anyone opposed to the project, please come forward.
I'm Julian Smith again. The first part of your agenda starts with consider approval to demolish the current structure. And I certainly approve of that, but I don't know why this is even on your agenda as a statement. I don't think it's appropriate for the planning board, in this case, to be asked to approve the demolition of the current structure. What would have been much more appropriate is have the county commission, county government, looked at this building and said for years now it has encroached across the property line. It has encroached across the setback line, not only the setback line, but the property line. The owner of the property has placed a deck, a wooden deck, on top of the Johnson Rocks, and are not on the property in question. And not only that, but when the deck became unstable, it was not removed. It's dangerous. The property owner or his tenants have put up in the past no trespassing signs on county property, etc. So tearing down this building would be a great improvement. And the building that will replace it, I'm sure, will be a great improvement. But that doesn't mean you should be approving this particular application, at least not without some significant stipulations and conditions. And I cannot think of a better property on St. Simon's Island on which a public sidewalk should be required. I come from an experience on a planning board where public sidewalks are required for almost everything. If the public were invited to walk and look at this property and look at the neighborhood and look at the park and then look at the beach, they might start asking questions such as, why immediately to the south and a little bit to the west of this property is there a condominium building that has used 100-foot wide public right-of-way of what used to be Railroad Street for lawn? The county allowed them to use it for lawn, didn't abandon the property. We need more parking in this area? Well, let's take down that fence that keeps the public off of public property now being maintained as a lawn. That's a separate issue. All right. Let's talk about the statement in the application. We're told that it's 6 condominium units with, according to the application, 10 sleeping rooms. Each of those 6 units has an office. The office on the site plan is shown with the door. I'm not suggesting that you ask the site plan to be, or the architectural plan to be modified to take the doors off the hinges and take the doors out. Because owners could put up a curtain, put up doors after the fact. In practical terms, this building has at least 16 sleeping rooms, plus a family dining and kitchen area, which could, of course, be used for sleeping when there's an overflow of guests. Now, given that the applicant is TerraCap LLC, a Florida outfit that identifies itself as a management firm made up of, quote, value-driven real estate investors, unquote, focus on, quote, migratory trends, whatever that means, international home buying, or we know what that means, folks in Dubai being induced to buy condos on St. Simon's, and Intrastate population movement.
Ah.
Intrastate population movement. A lovely term. These are the applicants. This is what they say on their website.
Mr. Smith, your time has expired. Would you please wrap it up?
Okay. Well, I believe it's reasonable to suspect that the six condos would be marketed as timeshares or to out-of-state or foreign homeowners who would be expected to turn them over to the management firm for vacation rentals. In other words, you, as a planning commission, and we, as the public, have no way of knowing how many occupants or visitors are likely to increase the demand for off-site parking, to increase the demand for police and services, et cetera, et cetera. Please, if you're going to approve this, impose some sensible condition that will somehow stop this from becoming a nuisance. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak in opposition to the project?
Yes, thank you. My name is Jeff Kilgore, and I have a question regarding the site plan application. In the ordinance, 619.2, little a, number 17 and 18, I think, addresses drainage and stormwater. Number 20 specifically says that location of the stormwater detention facility be on the site plan. Is it on the site plan?
Yes, it is. It is on the site plan. Right? Underneath the stone, underneath the building. Let's see.
The location of the storage is on the site plan.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Does anyone else want to speak?
Yes, Madam Chairman, I'm Monica Smith, and while I don't have a particular objection to this particular project, I want to call the board's attention to the fact that we have a large section in that part of St. Simon's that is zoned for RR, resort residential. What is there now are a lot of single family houses. And yet, every one of those lots is going to qualify for a resort residential, which I think is up to 32 bedrooms per acre. Now, you are going to be contemplating the revision of our comprehensive plan. The revision of the comprehensive plan is a good opportunity to look at whether or not the zoning that is currently there is consistent with what we want our comprehensive plan to do for us in the future. While you are going to have a consultant come in and make proposals about what should be in your comprehensive plan, I hope that the Planning Commission will take a serious interest in what goes into that comprehensive planning process and that we downzone St. Simon's Island significantly, not by saying you can't have split lots or anything like that, but by looking at areas and indicating which areas are already sufficiently occupied by people and making the zoning consistent with that. We do want people to be able to replace their single family homes, but we do not want to have a hotel on every lot all the way down to the lighthouse. And that's what you're going to get between ocean and the ocean if we don't change the zoning designation. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else want to speak in opposition to the project? Hearing none, seeing none, the public comment period is closed. Does the applicant want to speak in rebuttal on any of these issues that have been raised?
Madam Chair, I think we've answered the questions, have we not?
Okay, thank you.
Sure. And just one more time, you said you were, I'm still going back to the height, you were using fill to go up to a certain level?
If I may, Madam Chair, now I've tried once more. The ground floor.
Right.
The,
no, I just said, are you using fill? That's all I need to know.
No, we aren't using fill.
Okay, that's all we need.
Thank you. Any other questions? Any discussion?
I'd like, again, to state how we intend to control the number of sleeping. What was your suggestion?
That potentially to modify the plans for the offices, that they would not have doors to be framed in a way in which doors could be added in a later time.
And we can do that? Or?
Well, it would have to be acceptable to be, I mean, you could include that in your motion. The applicant could then, you know, revise their plans accordingly or not, or... The way that our ordinance defines sleeping rooms, is largely related to whether or not it has direct access to a bathroom, which the offices do not have direct access to a bathroom without going through another private space. So that's the way in which the sleeping rooms are defined.
We've had so much trouble in these people with the playhouse, and I just would like to ask, I mean, can we limit what can be done in the offices? I don't want to get too deep in the thing, but it seems to me subject to abuse.
Commissioner Humphreys, we appreciate and don't disagree with your concern. Right now, I'm speaking for myself, staff would not be able to give you a definitive way right now to ensure compliance and not use of things that are not currently labeled as sleeping rooms for sleeping rooms. If it's the pleasure of the commission, we're happy to work with the applicant and research that question and provide you some options. Or it would be an enforcement issue after the fact.
I don't know how you enforce it. We've had this discussion before when it came up about substandard lots and what could be built. It was almost implied that we'd have a county bed check out tonight and all these buildings. I mean, I'm sure a lot of folks here have a house or a condominium or an apartment, and you've had family here, and you've had them sleeping everywhere. I mean, I don't know how you enforce that. I don't think you can. I mean, you know, I think we're getting into some kind of intrusion that I don't think we really want to do. I don't want somebody coming by and checking my house, see if somebody's sleeping in the office or in the kitchen. I mean, you got to be practical about things. Use a little common sense.
Well, Commissioner Willis, I will point out that all other applicable county codes would apply. The noise ordinance would be enforced. Any other type of complaints that are typically the result of a lot of people in a small space, we can enforce all of those ordinances.
Madam Chair, I'd like to make a motion. I'm going to approve application SB 3433 as presented.
Is there a second?
I second.
Any discussion?
I just want to clarify that again, this is in a sewage and water area that is over capacity at this time, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Any other comments or discussion, sir?
Yes, I'd like to make a suggestion that I think that with regard to the conversation that we heard earlier about parking and the concern about the crowded nature of the neighborhood, that perhaps our motion might include subject to no interference with public parking. And as it currently exists, doesn't mean they can't be moved. And that I would also
suggest that we make this subject to all conditions as specified in the letter by the Georgia Department of Natural Resources, since this is in the vital zone.
When you talk about the character of the neighborhood, if you've been over there with Gentry or been over there, you notice across the street, down the street, all the way to King Prince, they've built a lot of multi-family units, very tall, taking up a lot of property, space on their property. And so, personally, I think this is quite compatible with the area. Because of what's even across the street in Tadacorn Street. So I think the structure is compatible. I think it will be an improvement to the property. As to the water and sewer issue, we're told by another government agency, JWSC, that that issue should be resolved by September of this year. So the applicant's not going to get attacked. But if we approve the application, they can at least go forward and start getting their construction plans done and everything. And they probably need a tap before September.
I understand what you're saying.
And as just one other point, making this subject to DNR, I would not want to, I don't think we can, Will Worley, I don't think we can make our motion subject to another public agency's requirements. I mean, they're going to have to follow DNR requirements.
Exactly.
And us making it subject to that, I'm not sure we have the authority. We would have the authority to pass on something like
it would,
that.
It would then put all the requirements all in one place, so for ease of our staff, so they would know immediately that that's attached, and so no, you don't need to be calling DNR about that issue.
But we if you put make it part of the responsibility, we can't enforce that. We're not enforcing DNR.
Exactly.
So I don't see it making that a requirement as part of our motion of approval.
Let me comment with regard to your statement about the building, and I agree with you that it is what's happening in the neighborhood. Every time we permit and new ones of these are built, we are increasing the crowdedness of the availability of parking in the neighborhood, including on the public street. And so there were statements regarding the application about changing the parking situation. At some point, we will have a difficult problem in that neighborhood. I think it's appropriate that we attach appropriate conditions so that we're not contributing to this as we move forward, because every time these buildings fill up and then we all invite all of our friends come on down for Memorial Weekend, we're going to have a traffic problem in the neighborhood as we continue to convert from single family to multi-dwelling. Thank you.
Mr. Mayor, Bill Weston. That's the county enforcement that has to deal with that, not us. I mean, the public parking is not going away there, so it's still there. If that's violated, you know, that's county enforcement will be dealing with that. I guess the county police too. So, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but, you know, I don't know how you can impose anything on them if they're not taking away any of that public parking.
Well, they're asking us to approve a variance from what currently exists.
It's moving one. That's all. Still, you're not limiting.
And are they, okay, so maybe I can be educated. Are they moving that parking space to already existing available public space?
Yes.
They're creating a new space?
The area where they are proposing to move the space, there's not currently parking there.
And they're not going to encroach on the public access way to the beach, is that correct?
Correct.
So they're going to move it on to their own property?
It's still within the public right-of-way. It's on the other side. It's basically their driveway. Their current driveway is to the side of their property, and they're basically centering their driveway so that they can access the parking underneath the building. So it's shifting the driveway over, and it's also the new driveway is a little bit wider to provide the access, and so it's moving the parking space that currently there is a parking space that's in the location of where the new proposed driveway is going to be. So they're moving that parking space over into an area that does not currently have public parking marked.
I think I heard you say they're going to move the parking space to a public right-of-way.
I'm sorry, if I could add to this. So all of the parking on the street now is currently in existing public right-of-way. Along this property's frontage, to date, its total frontage, there are 5 public parking spaces. They are going to relocate where their driveway is on that, and once this is constructed, if it's approved, along the frontage of their property, there will be 5 public parking spaces.
For the public, not
for the public.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions or discussion?
Again, I just want to point out the plat that was presented to the DNR is quite different from the one that we're looking at tonight. Which was found on the DNR website.
Commissioner Kaker, just so you probably have a copy of what you referenced, that was included in your packet as well, the site plan.
Right, I'm
okay.
Saying that.
Okay, I just want to make sure you have it.
Yeah. Anybody else wants to see it?
Okay. We're ready to go? Okay. The motion is to approve application SP3433 as presented. It's been seconded. All those in favor, raise your right hand. That's 4, 5. Opposed? 5-2, motion passes. Our next item is SP3500, Commerce and Restaurant. Consider site plan approval for a proposed restaurant located at 549 and 547 Ocean Boulevard. The property is owned Village Mixed Use, VMU, and is located within the Island Preservation District. The applicant has received Village Preservation and conditional use approval for the use and the proposed changes to building DP3482 and CP3481. Parcel IDs 04-04694 and 04-04695. Diane Durant, applicant for MS3 LLC owner. Staff report.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you.
You may recall this application came before you last month. This is located on Ocean Boulevard in the village. This is the map illustrating the location of the property. There currently is an existing structure which the applicant is proposing to renovate and make additions to for a restaurant. The area of the property is 0.46 acres. It is zoned village mixed use, and the conditional use permit was approved by the Board of Commissioners on May 4th. They do meet the requirements set forth in the zoning ordinance for minimum lot size and lot width. This is the site plan for the proposed project. I will again walk through it for each of the items that's required, the vicinity map, etc., shown here. The information regarding the development standards. The site plan, I'll take a moment while we're zoomed in to walk through the site plan in particular because it has changed since you saw the sketch plan. If you'll recall, when this came before you for the conditional use permit, a sketch plan was submitted in conjunction with that permit application. And some modifications have been made to that site plan. The parking is still located, so this is the existing footprint of the current house. They are proposing to add screen porches on the sides. The front already has a screened porch. They're also doing an addition in the back for the kitchen. And previously, this was a loop drive with the entrance here and angle parking that came around the exit here. There were concerns brought up during the review of the plans regarding visibility because of the oak trees that exist out in front of the current house. So the site plan was modified so that this is now an entrance only, and the exit is moved over to this side in order to address those line of sight issues. They have, and that also required moving or modifying the parking from what was currently angled parking to 90 degree parking, as you see here, with the exception of the employee parking that is located back in the back of the property. Even with the changes made to the parking layout, they still are able to preserve the existing trees on site, with the exception of one palm tree. So I know that was something that was raised before. And they are also requesting to be able to use pervious surface for the parking lot. So most of this area would be gravel, with the exception of the dumpster pad, the ADA parking spaces, and I believe the applicant can speak. I think those are the only two areas that they were showing to have concrete as opposed to the pervious surface. There's currently a sidewalk along Ocean Boulevard. They do have a pedestrian access that connects the structure to that public access way. It's the development standards and the flood information about the flood zone. The buffer I'll show you in just a moment. This is where they'll be connecting to the existing utilities for water and sewer. This is the existing building footprint, which shows the dimensions of the buildings and the additions that are being proposed. The building elevations are shown here, very similar to what you saw last month with the village preservation application. Again, this is illustrating the parking, which I reviewed just a moment ago, as well as the ingress and egress to the site. The employee parking, again, is located at the rear of the property. Another change that was made previously, the dumpster was shown back here along the rear property line. With the reconfiguration of the parking, they now have moved it over here, which does get it further away from the adjacent residential houses that are back on the other side of the rear property line. And it does have a type D buffer as required. The proposed sign location shown here. This is their landscaping plan, including the buffer as required. And this is their lighting plan. One of the requirements for a restaurant in the village mixed use is pertaining to lighting. So they have submitted their lighting plan, which demonstrates that the light that's provided on their site will not spill over into the adjacent properties. And this is also an issue that came up during the when this was presented for the conditional use permit at our last meeting. I know it's a lot, I apologize. Sorry, I know it's very hard to read. This basically is a summary of the 9 items for consideration by the Planning Commission. And these are the 4 additional requirements for a restaurant as a conditional use in the village district. Basically, that speak to the 15-foot setback, which they do have. They are proposing an 8-foot fence along the rear property line. And we had some discussions previously about the current fence that is located on the adjacent property that's also a restaurant. This fence is 12 feet high. This is directly, so this is the this is the adjacent restaurant. This is a 12-foot fence, and this is a 10-foot fence. And then that 10-foot fence transitions down to a lower fence. This is the back of the tabby house that's adjacent to the proposed restaurant. So that's just to give you a sense of the scale of the fence that's there now. The other conditions that are required for a restaurant in the village mixed use are pertaining to lighting, employee parking, and the location of the dumpsters, all of which have been indicated on the site plan. The The possible motions are to approve the application, approve the application subject to any necessary modifications, deny or defer, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Madam Chair, I have a question. When we discussed it before, there was a lighting issue on the adjacent property, the Moot Cow property. Has that been addressed?
I have put in a work order with our code enforcement office. Building inspection office actually measures the light meters, so they are right now verifying if there's a violation to then contact the owner to resolve that.
I have a question about motions. They're requesting the ability to utilize gravel for surfacing the parking lot. And I don't see that as that part. We need to.
Yes, ma'am. I would recommend including that in your motion under the second bullet for any necessary modifications that would be requested by the applicant.
Because I think that was one of their points last time for the conditional use permit was they wanted to keep it as characteristic of the village area as possible, not having to pavement where there is none.
Yes, ma'am. And because it is shown on the site plan, by virtue of approving the site plan, you would also be approving the use of that pervious material as part of that
as
site plan application. So if you want to make sure that's clear, you can include the motion, but it would, if you approve the site plan, it would include that provision.
All
right. Did we lose any parking places as a result of the reconfiguration of the building?
No, sir, they still meet the parking requirement. And just to clarify, on the parking, you may recall that we were discussing that the driveway does, the property owner has two parcels there, and the driveway goes somewhat over the property line. So we asked them to provide parking to the number of parking spaces required for both the existing residential building, the Tabby House, as well as the restaurant, and they have met that requirement.
Mr. Meadows, if I could add to that, the modifications to the flow on the site were done in conjunction with the applicant, the traffic department, and the engineering department in order to save and preserve those oak trees that exist on the road to make sure we minimize any line of sight issues. So we worked together to preserve those trees.
And last time they agreed to a 12-foot fence, and on the application it says an 8-foot. They did verbally agree to do a 12-foot.
I would defer to the applicant.
Was there a reason?
I did discuss the fence with their agent, and it was the property owner's opinion that an 8-foot fence would be more appropriate for the scale and the style of the house, and so that's what they're proposing.
I have a question too. Now they added a porch because I think on the conditional use, we saw there was a porch to the side and the front porch. And then on the left side of the building, there was a ramp. And now there's a porch there. So they added a porch, it seems. And in doing so, they had last time still the 19 parking spaces and the patron space of 816, but now that they've added a porch, was that patron space that needed to be added to be considered for the parking?
It's my understanding that the porches are a waiting area that the applicant can see. It's my understanding that the porches are not, they are not eating areas, that they are waiting areas, but the applicant can provide more clarification.
So it's not a patron space, I see.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. That we would use for parking. Okay,
yes,
that's good. Any questions for staff? Applicant present?
Present.
Okay. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, thank you for allowing us to be at this meeting. We really appreciate it. I'm Diane Duran, I'm the owner, and we're very excited about this project because, as you know, this land has been vacant and it hasn't been used in quite some time. And what our goal is to make this an enhancement of the village experience. And
and adding the porch, from my standpoint, from an architectural standpoint, it made a more balanced look to the building. Otherwise, it sort of looked like it was lopsided. And by wrapping that porch around, it's consistent with the other houses, and it makes more of a southern look. So we're very excited about this project. And this is Palmer. This is going to be his restaurant, and I'll let him answer any questions about the restaurant itself.
Okay. Any questions for the applicant? We've just heard that the additional porch, the one that you said, and I agree, balance, it looked cool with the porch on both sides, that it's not going to be an additional patron meeting spaces.
Yeah. It's a screened-in porch, so it's not enclosed, so in the summer it's going to be too hot, in the winter it might be too chilly, so we can't really use it as service area.
Okay, but you are using the other screened porch on the other side that's patron. The porch on the other side, are showing as patron area, right?
It's all going to be tied together as waiting area. And you asked about the ramp, and I'll explain about the ramp. That original ramp, once we changed the site plan to accommodate the trees and the traffic flow, it allowed us that extra space. That ramp was to get a service ramp. So it wasn't a handicap ramp. The handicap ramp is on the other side. Right. So now we're able to bring in the service area, and that little ramp comes into the kitchen. And so it closes off. So it's not a patron or a traffic area. It's only to service and supply the kitchen.
Okay.
Does that answer your question?
It absolutely does. Thank you very much. Any other questions for applicant? Okay, thank you.
Could I?
Yes, please.
I would like to, my name is Bert Etheridge. I'm representing the client in Robert Civil Engineering, and we would like to see if it would be okay with you guys if we could get variance or some relief on the type E buffer. The trees that we tried to save in front created a line of sight problem, and now that we're planting more trees actually on the right of way, it's going to grow into the existing trees that are already there, plus it's going to create an additional line of sight problem, which is why we had to do the redesign on that plan.
So what exactly are you asking for?
So the type E buffer is it's a large deciduous tree every 50 feet.
On Ocean Boulevard?
Yes, ma'am.
On Ocean?
Yes, ma'am.
And there are already existing trees on Ocean there.
Right. A lot. I think there's like four.
Madam Chairman, we discussed this when Mr. Etheridge came to a development review team meeting, and in light of making sure that we maintain the oaks and maintain the line of sight visibility, we were able as staff to determine that we could allow them to have the quantities required in a type E buffer, place the large things that would impede sight could be placed on other pieces of the property, and those lower shrubs and things would still be in that buffer area. So staff feels that we've addressed this at the staff level.
So we are going to be required to provide a buffer, is that accurate?
I apologize, sir. Please.
I think what they're saying is they want to plant the trees somewhere else.
Right. On the back side of the lot, which is fine. I mean, we can make that work. Yeah. And you're saying keep low on Ocean. And that's what really
needs to be done. Smart.
Yes, ma'am. So, for example, in a buffer, there are a certain number of shrubs required, a certain number of trees. The trees are what would impede your line of sight. And so we're saying keep the quantity required for this site, but move it to other locations where it doesn't impede visibility entering and exiting the site. And staff have discussed that as a development.
Do like let a landscaper do the design of the bushes instead of just having a straight hedge? It would be kind of made nicer if we could have it.
Can we get the variance? I haven't got an answer for that.
think variance is by the not by this body.
Yeah. I think we did the variance.
What?
We did the variance.
Yeah.
As part of the site plan approval, you can do a variance to the buffer with approval. Staff is telling you that we think at the staff level, we can accomplish an attractive aesthetic landscape while meeting that requirement without a variance. It's your decision, which you choose to do.
So the applicant's clear and I'm clear. So you're saying at staff level, you can let them plant low and put the required plantings for the e-buffer in the back of the property?
Anything that's tall and would impede the line of sight, we can allow them to meet their quantities elsewhere on the property where it does not impede traffic flow or visibility entering or exiting the site. I think Mr. Fortune is just asking for a waiver of that. We are saying we think the trees should be there, but on a piece of the property where it's not impeding line of sight to enter and exit the property.
And you would agree that they don't have to put a hedge, a solid hedge?
Absolutely.
Because that would affect business.
Absolutely.
And as well as being unattractive in that area.
Yes.
We really want to make it pretty.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. And I do believe we can find the balance with a landscape architect or an architect for an aesthetic planting that does create a visual buffer from the sidewalk to the restaurant. I do believe we can do
that. Not too tall.
Yes, ma'am.
Because it's a cute house. I mean, it's a cute house. Okay. All right. Thank you. Did you have a question?
We're not voting on the 12-foot wall, accurate?
I believe it's proposed as 8.
Yeah.
It is proposed as 8. And my recollection was last time that you said you would work with the folks behind you and talk to them and do what was appropriate.
I know at least one of our neighbors is here and have spoken with him and his wife. I'm very happy for them to say whatever they would like to say, too. So.
Okay.
I was just coming off of the comments from the neighbors last time.
No, I was just checking. I just wanted to make sure.
I'd like to make one comment, if I could.
Yeah.
Not only does Mr. Fortune offer a good restaurant, but we've had dealings with him before, and that he has kept his word, which is very important.
What about my reputation?
So.
The food's good, too. I have to say that.
He's kept his word and done what he said he was going to do.
Yes, sir. I agree with that.
I'm going to get that recorded. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Any other comments? Discussion? Public comment? We have a public comment period now, then I'll open it up. Anyone want to speak in favor of this project? Please come forward.
Hi, my name is Jim Huckey. I'm one of the neighbors that was here last time.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for allowing me to speak. I very much look forward to this restaurant. I bet my wife and I will be some of the best people that come and visit there. Concerning the plan, I appreciate you taking into account the parking issues that I've talked about. I'm still looking forward to the lighting issue. That's moved kind of not their problem, but I do appreciate you taking that on. Because lighting is a concern for us in terms of a commercial property that will be next door. That said, my preference would be for a color fence, but I will work with Mr. Fortune. I look forward to having him as a good neighbor, and I'm willing to work with him to make it right for both of us. So I'm not going to be hard over on the 12-foot fence. That said, I am a little concerned about this variance you're asking about. They're talking about trying to keep it looking island-like, and the first thing they're talking about is cutting down all the trees that are out in front of the place. Particularly
when... No, they're not cutting down any trees. No.
Well,
not cutting down any
trees. I would like to have them address where in the back of the property they're going to put these trees, because there really isn't much room in the back of the property to add these trees. So just a question for the staff, Madam Chairman, to address where these additional plantings would be. Bottom line, I'm really looking forward to them as neighbors. I think, as you said, I think Mr. Fortune is a straight-up guy. I think he'll be a great neighbor in Diane Duran. And when I think about what could have been there in other than this, a viewpoint condo, a Pilar Hotel, or a Dollar General, I thank my lucky stars to have a neighbor like Mr. Fortune. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments? Anyone else like to speak in favor of the project? Okay. Is anyone opposed to the project? Please come forward. Hearing none, seeing none, I'm going to close the public comment period. And
I move to approve application SP3500 as presented.
Madam Chair, Mr. Humphreys, if I could, in talking with staff to make sure that there aren't any issues with relocating the deciduous tree requirement on the rear of the property, we are comfortable with approving the site plan with the deciduous tree portion of the buffer requirement waived. And that way we can get as many trees on the site as we can, but not have to come back to you if for some reason we can't get that exact number.
That's what I said.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Humphreys. I appreciate that.
With the deciduous tree waiver?
I think Ms. Grabowski is going to give us the very official wording of this. The large deciduous tree requirement. And perhaps because it is a fairly tight site and they are preserving a lot of the existing trees, perhaps if you would waive the requirement for the large deciduous trees and allow staff to work with the applicant to come as close as practicable to meeting the requirements of the buffer elsewhere on the site.
I have some on that way. So your motion,
that's what I said,
is to approve application SP3500 as presented and to waive the large deciduous tree requirement.
Yes.
Second. Is there a second? We've got a second. Any discussion?
Yes, I would just like to understand what we said we're going to agree to waive. This is along Ocean Boulevard in front of the property only. Sure. And so tell me what that means, that we're going to waive that.
Before this buffer, they're required to have at least one large deciduous tree for every 50 foot of linear frontage. So we take their linear frontage of the property, divide it by 50, and that's how many large deciduous trees would be required. So that is the piece of the buffer requirement that you're waiving. There's still a requirement for small deciduous trees and plantings that we would work with them to install on the site in a very aesthetically pleasing way, keeping in character with the village.
And there's already trees in that buffer.
Yes, ma'am. There
so
already
this
are.
Way they don't have to take out any trees to plant the big trees. Right. So they leave the trees that are there.
Small trees and the other vegetation, that's part of the requirement. We're just waiving the large tree part. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir, that is correct.
Any further discussion?
And just to follow up for consistency's sake, to point out again that our letter from Joint Water Sewer says this proposed development lies in the sewer basin that is currently over capacity. And they do say it is expected to resolve by September, but again, at this point in time, it's over capacity.
Okay. Any further comments? All those in favor of approving SP application SP3500 and waiving the large deciduous tree requirement, please raise your hand.
1, 2, 3.
Opposed? Abstain?
One
abstention. Okay, I think that concludes our business. Thank you very much for coming.